But there is nothing that can be considered the result of sophisticated astronomy.
Why do you think Muslim scholars were particularly interested in the heavens and the revolution of the stars?
I think they were interested in science in general terms. For example, calculating the sacred direction. If you have to say your prayers, you must face towards Mecca. Calculating the direction of Mecca from a given place is not so easy. It is a complicated mathematical problem for which the Arabs had exact solutions from the 9th century.
One of the ways in which the Muslims solved these problems was by developing a Greek instrument called the astrolabe. This is a calculator for telling the time of night or day. If it's lined up on a star above the horizon, the angle can be registered with a movable needle. The measurement is then transferred to the reverse side of the astrolabe, where a base plate represents the geographical location. And a star grid, like a map of the heavens, shows the position of the stars. By aligning the needle to the grid using the measurements, the time can be read off the face of the astrolabe, just like a clock. The astrolabe enabled nighttime navigation, which helped to advance sea travel, and this in turn set the stage for the coming era of worldwide exploration and discovery. Cordoban scientists were streets ahead of the rest of Europe, especially when it came to medicine. This account comes from an Islamic physician who encountered a Christian doctor at work. They brought me a knight who had an abscess on his leg and a woman suffering from consumption. I made a plaster for the knight and the swelling opened and improved. For the woman, I prescribed a diet to revive her consumption. But then the Frankish doctor arrived and objected. Bring me a strong knight with a well-sharpened battle axe, he said. The knight struck a blow, the marrow of the leg spurted out, and the wounded man died on the spot. As for the woman, their doctor affirmed, the devil must have entered her head. Then he grasped a razor and cut an incision in the shape of a cross, exposing the bone of the skull and rubbing salt into the wound. The woman died in the instant. I returned home, having learned much about the medicine of the Christians. The hospitals of Cordoba were performing operations which wouldn't be seen in the rest of Europe for hundreds of years. The city's most famous surgeon was a man called Abu Qasis. He spent 40 years compiling a hugely influential medical compendium.
Chapter 30 dealt with surgery, and these are just some of the instruments that were illustrated in that chapter. This is a specialist device used by eye surgeons for the relief of hypertension. And these two over here were employed to perform successful tracheotomies. And in fact, the Abu Qasis method was still popular well into the 20th century.
As well as large scientific collections, more everyday documents have survived from Islamic Cordoba. These give a detailed insight to the society that was created here.
What kinds of things are being recorded on these bits of paper?
In these documents, it was written everything. Absolutely everything.
So does that mean that people in the lower classes of society could read?
Yes, they are poor people with a very good education. The education is a way to be a better Muslim. So being a better Muslim means that you know the Quran and you know everything of the law. The law is not a king law. It is a God law.
Divine law.
Divine law.
Have you got any physical examples of these
documents? Yes, I have one. Well, it is a contract about plowing the land. For 2 years, we have to plant it with wheat and food, and he gets from this proportion of the production. The Muslim give a new thing. The land is mine. I rent you the land, and you give me a part of the production. people are interested not in having hunting lands, like a lord or squire in England. The landlord rent his land.
And it's empowering as well, because if you're the lowest rung of society, and yet you have some rights to your own land, and you can keep a lot of the produce.
Yes.
Every piece of evidence from Cordoba adds to the picture of a civilized and highly sophisticated city. It had medical centers, an organized legal system, and libraries full of academics and scientists working on ideas which were light years ahead of anything else in Europe. By the 10th century, Cordoba had become the official capital of Al-Andalus. People flocked here to work, either in the city's shops and markets, or on rented land outside. In the year 912, a new ruler came to power. He was to take Cordoba to even greater heights.
Abdulrahman III was only 21 when he became ruler of Cordoba. With a resounding statement of self-confidence, he declared himself the Caliph, the commander-in-chief of the faithful. With that title, he claimed to be the supreme leader of the Islamic world. At a stroke, he repositioned Muslim Spain, so it was no longer a Western outpost, but instead a key power in Islam.
And to complement his role as Caliph, Abdulrahman III built himself one of the biggest royal palaces in the world. While the English kings of the same period were living in modest wooden halls, Abdulrahman III needed 10,000 workmen to construct this enormous palace complex, which was decorated with African white marble. The alabaster palace, surrounded by acres of date palms, was described as a concubine lying in the arms of a black eunuch. It was called Madina al-Zahra, after the caliph's favourite. Archaeologists have reconstructed barely 10% of the original site.
The idea here is that the caliph dominates. What he's really doing with the landscape is demonstrating that Medina al-Zahra is the strongest territory in the peninsula. Our excavations reveal the city to be at the cutting edge of technical, architectural and scientific development. Now, to do this on such an enormous scale requires incredible sophistication. Nothing like this existed in the world.
At the center of the complex lies Abdulrahman's throne room.
What do you think drove Abdulrahman to build such an opulent place?
Abdulrahman had this built during the last year of his life. It was a symbol of consolidation of his economic and political power. Seated in this throne, the caliph must have felt himself master of all Al-Andalus' destiny.
Visitors from all over Europe were received here. A monk from Germany called John of Gorse left a record of his trip.
You have to try and imagine the impression this place would have made on John of Gorse.